Now that we've discussed the atomic nucleus and what's at the center of an atom, we're ready to discuss now the electronic structure of an atom. We'll start this with what's called the Bohr model of the atom. And historically, this is a very significant development in how we think about what an atom is, what its structure is, and therefore how it behaves. Historically, originally, people knew that there were positive and negative charges, and we had seen this in experiments, but they didn't really know how those were organized in an actual atom. In the plum pudding model, as it's called, we have sort of this distribution on the left here, where we maybe have a big positive charge, so you can see a positive sign in the middle there, that was sort of distributed through the whole atom, with maybe negative charges interspersed between, sort of like plums and plum pudding. But then some experiments were conducted where different kinds of particles were shot at an atom to see how they bounced off of it. And to everybody's great surprise, they found that they would bounce off a hard core in the center of the atom, but would otherwise go right through. And this is the Bohr model of the atom, which you can see on the right. In the center, we have the nucleus, which we've already discussed. It has positive charges, which are protons, as well as neutral charges, the neutrons. And then on the outside, you have these electrons that are very small, small particles that are orbiting at a very great distance relative to the size of the nucleus itself. So this Bohr atom has a few more properties, namely, in perhaps most importantly, the electronic structure. So this electronic structure has different energy levels. These are the places that the electrons are allowed to be orbiting around your nucleus. So unlike planets that are orbiting each other, you can't have the orbits be anywhere you would like. For electrons orbiting a nucleus, they have to be in very discrete, very distinct energy levels. So for example, this first energy level, the one closest to the nucleus, is called the first energy level, or the ground state of this atom. And then the electrons could go to the second energy level and so on. But again, these have to be discrete. They have to be very particular levels, and you can never be halfway between a level. One other thing about these orbitals, and we'll discuss this a little bit more later as well, is that there can only be a certain number of electrons in these orbitals. So you see, we're already introducing many restrictions on exactly how this Bohr model atom can work. So keep track of the restrictions that we're imposing. One, we can only be in particular energy levels. And two, we can only have a certain number of electrons in a given energy level. This number is given by 2 times the energy level squared. So for example, in the first energy level, this ground state that's closest to the nucleus, we can have 2 times 1 squared, or 2 electrons in that energy level. And we could calculate this for a number of others. So for example, for the second energy level, we have 2 times 2 squared, or 2 times 4, which is 8 electrons that can reside in the second energy level. The typical hydrogen atom, which is something we'll be focusing on as we go forward, looks something like this. It has a proton at the center with no neutrons and no other protons, just one positive charge sitting right in the center, and then electrons orbiting it. And again, with no other neutrons anywhere in the nucleus as well. And again, the lowest energy level, the N equals 1 level, is called the ground state for the electron to be in. So this phrase, the ground state, comes up over and over again. So certainly be familiar with the fact that if I say ground state, I'm referring to the N equals 1 energy level. If the electron goes to a higher state, like the N equals 2 or even the N equals 3 energy levels, we say that the electron, or the atom itself, is in an excited state. It has more energy because it needs to use energy to get that electron to that higher energy level, to that higher state. One way to get an electron to a higher energy level from a lower one, like the ground state, is to hit it with some light. So we can see here, we have a photon on its way in. It hits the electron, and the electron is raised to the higher energy level. And then we would say again that the atom even is in the excited state when the electron is in a higher energy level than the ground state. When the electron comes back down from that excited state, we have a very important phenomenon, which is the exact opposite of what I just mentioned. Instead of absorbing a photon and going into a higher energy level, it falls to a lower energy level and emits light. So you can see this exactly happening in the picture here. We have an electron in the excited state. It falls into the ground state, and it will emit a photon. And that photon has a particular amount of energy when it gets emitted. We can calculate this energy just by using conservation of energy. So if the atom had one amount of energy and then changed to a lower amount of energy, we can calculate the difference. We can calculate how much energy was lost. So we write that in the same terminology that we've been using a delta sign to represent change. So the change in the energy of the atom is the final energy that it had, or rather the excited energy, the initial energy, the first energy, minus the ground state energy. And this is because we have the excited energy being a bigger number, and then the ground state energy being a smaller number. And using this equation, we can find what energy the photon must have, again, just using conservation of energy. The photon energy is actually something we've already calculated, if you remember from before. So we have the photon energy here is just Planck's constant h times the frequency of that photon, which again determines what color the photon is. If it's a red photon, a lower energy light, it is a lower frequency, and vice versa for the higher frequencies. It's more blue at higher frequencies, which are higher energies. And also don't forget that we can also calculate this from the wavelength if we don't know the frequency, but instead know the wavelength of the light, since we can relate the two using our velocity equation that we've already discussed. This atomic structure can keep going. We've only showed so far the first and second energy levels, but we could, in principle, go to higher and higher energy levels, and they would look something like this. They're not equally spaced. You can see that going from the atom, the center of the atom, to the ground state, we have one radius, one distance, and then as we go further and further up, these distances decrease from one energy level to the next.